Hello, good morning, everybody, and welcome to this third in our series of four virtual seminar events that we're running during May, all about defined benefit, DB, pensions, and advice. Thank you once again for registering for this event, and we do hope that you and all those close to you are staying well. Thanks also to everyone who's seen one or both of our first two sessions over the past couple of weeks. If you missed last week's session, a link to it was attached to the email reminders you would have received yesterday from my colleague Emma Godfrey. And I think Emma will also be putting links to both our first two sessions in the chat stream for this meeting, if you can see that on Microsoft Teams. If for whatever reason you can't see them though, please do reach out to one of us and we can provide it to you. My name is Peter Lovegrove, and my colleague Rebecca Prestage and I work in Grant Thornton's regulatory advisory practice. Good morning again, Rebecca. How are you?
Morning, Peter. I'm very well on this lovely sunny morning. How are you?
Indeed, yes, fine, thank you. Rebecca and I are both pension transfer specialists, and our team have done lots of work over the past couple of years with firms and other industry parties on various aspects of DB pensions and advice. And again, as we're all still largely locked down, we wanted to take some time to share some observations and insights with you. A couple of logistical and housekeeping points. Forgive me, those of you who are familiar with these. Please note that this is a virtual event. It's being recorded. And it will be distributed to everybody who registered as soon as we can afterwards. And once again, you'll understand, we do apologise in advance for any unexpected interruptions, be they technical or anything else. Like you, we're in our homes recording this, so we'll do our best to minimise interruptions, but thank you in advance for your understanding should they occur. Before we get stuck into our session today, it's perhaps helpful just to briefly summarise where we are across these four sessions, which are running every Wednesday during May at 10 o'clock. So a couple of weeks ago, Rebecca and I talked about the current state of the DB pension advice market. We talked about FCA expectations when either giving or reviewing advice. And we talked about the profound impact that the COVID-19 crisis is having and continues to have and will have. Last week, we talked about what we called the groundwork for good advice. So we talked about good practice we've seen on triage, fact-finding, information gathering, and charges and disclosure. Today's session is all about developing advised solutions that meet a client's true needs, a pretty meaty topic. And next week, in the final session in our series, we're going to be talking about what we've seen in terms of running a good advice process and the controls and governance that sit around that, so that everybody's protected. Those of you who've joined the first couple of sessions, you'll know the format's pretty straightforward. Each week, Rebecca and I will have a conversation to explore the topic of the day, but we would really like you to participate. If there's any questions or comments or observations that you would like to ask, please do submit them via the chat function. We'll do our best to address them either during or towards the end of the session. We had some really interesting questions during each of our first two sessions, for which many, many thanks. And we did share some thoughts by way of answers within the email reminders for today's session. We hope you've seen that and it's helpful. We have already had a few questions about today. We think that we're probably going to address some of them, at least during the conversation, but we will do our best to address anything outstanding towards the end, anything we receive during the session. Today's topic is perhaps the meatiest one so far, especially as we're going to be examining some different possible scenarios and what good advice might look like in those scenarios. So we'll do our very best to stick to the time. Please do forgive us, though, if we do go slightly over the 45 minutes. So with that disclaimer in mind, Rebecca, what's on the agenda today?
Thank you, Peter. So I think today, as you mentioned, we'll build on last week's session on fact finding to explore how to develop solutions that meet your customers' true needs, including things like the APTA, consideration of alternatives, cash flow modelling and investment advice. We'll look at the key components to a compliant, high quality DB pension advice solution. In what scenarios is a transfer more or less likely to be appropriate and why? And we'll explain what works well and the pitfalls to avoid. So we're going to take a brief step through the components of the APTA, the appropriate pension transfer analysis, including the transfer value comparator, TVC. We'll discuss the principles underpinning advice and the driver's advice and the main reasons that individuals sort of seek advice in the first place. We'll run through some scenarios when a transfer is more or less likely and most importantly why, and the consideration of alternative solutions. And then finally, we'll give you some top tips on how to create good suitability reports, whilst obviously appreciating that this can be subjective. As we've mentioned in previous sessions, we'll talk about this as though advice were happening now. But as with last week's session on fact finding, it's important to note that this is all just as relevant if you're reviewing advice that's been given in the past. And need to consider how well these areas have been covered and can be evidenced as such. So I think let's perhaps start with how the FCA sets out what it requires of advisors when formulating advice solutions regarding DB assets. We've mentioned the APTA and DBC in our first two sessions in this series, Peter. What are the key points of these requirements, do you think?
Well, I think, first of all, as everybody, of course, will know, the APTA and DBC requirements became effective in October 2018. And I think the FCA's thinking is basically that because no two customer situations are the same, it is advisors who are best placed to consider the detailed approach for what is appropriate for each individual customer. So the APTA is a concept, you know, it's an approach to advising customers on safeguarding pension benefits to generate a suitable recommendation based on the analysis of that particular customer's individual circumstances. And the TBC in the presentation of it is the only really specifically mandatory component. That said, however, you know, it's clear that the APTA is a crucial guide, even a to-do list of issues that the advisor should consider. And in practice, I think we found that it's not really possible to provide demonstrably suitable advice unless you've identified and at least considered all the various aspects of it. So we'll just try and trip through them as quickly as we possibly can. We spent quite a bit of time last week talking about how important it is to establish a customer's retirement and capital needs, retirement income and capital needs, and the importance of detailed fact finding in that respect. That's very important when you're obviously devising a solution, not least for cash flow modelling and capacity for loss purposes. And we're going to come back to that a little later. Your job as the advisor is to understand the role the DB scheme can play alongside any other assets the customer has in meeting the income and capital needs that your fact finding has established. And of course, for providing for a spouse or a partner and any dependents, and understanding how important that is to that individual customer. The advice needs to consider the impact on that customer and the risks to that customer should a transfer be made, sources of their retirement funds at any particular time. Only by doing that can you create a meaningful comparative analysis between the DB scheme and the benefits it provides and any alternatives that you might be considering. Obviously, you need to have a very good idea about the customer's risk profile, both for transfer risk attitude and investment risk attitude. You need to think about, I know Rick, you're going to come to this later, alternative ways of meeting the customer's objectives. You know, we talked last week about this idea of trying to sort of almost preserve membership of the scheme, if that's possible. Look for a way of meeting objectives by staying in the scheme. And also, the APTA asks advisors to consider tax implications. We've seen instances every now and again of advice resulting in somebody being in a higher tax bracket, which may not necessarily be a terrible thing, but it's certainly worth thinking about. And also, we talked last week about how we see too few instances of advisors considering state benefits as well. A couple of other important things, again, we touched on these last week. It's really important to project income and capital generation as it's needed for a reasonable period beyond someone's life expectancy to get the risks of funds right. And again, link here to cash flow modelling, which we'll come back to. And of course, finally, you've got to objectively consider for that customer with their scheme any PPF or indeed FSCS considerations that may be relevant to them in their situation. Then, of course, there is this one mandatory component, which is the transfer value comparator, the TVC. It's perhaps a relief for people to know that we don't really have time today to describe the TVC in loads of detail, or indeed the complexities and the merits of the various actuarial assumptions it uses. There's certainly scope for legitimate challenges in that respect in terms of the approach the FCA landed on. But I think for our purposes, when we're talking about crafting really, really good advice, we can say that the TVC is a really, really important tool in quantifying and personalising transfer risk to the individual customer right in front of you. Before an individual TVC is presented to that individual customer, transfer risk is an abstract concept. But the TVC, their TVC, when they see it, makes it real to them because it values, in pounds and pence, the DB benefits that they would be giving up, and it values in pounds and pence the estimate of what it would cost to replace them. So that's very powerful if the conversation is done well. And some good practice we have seen, actually, you don't need to do this, but we've found that a standalone conversation with the customer simply about the TVC can be very helpful, perhaps in between a fact-finding meeting and any interaction to present your recommendations. Because perhaps by the time you come to present your recommendations, and of course you need to present the TVC at that stage, any objections or musings or considerations the customer may have or want to have about it may not have been able to happen yet. So if there's time in the advice process, that's something that we've seen work very well.
Interesting. Thank you, Peter. I quite like the idea of a separate TVC meeting or discussion. So later on today, we're going to identify some drivers of advice and then imagine yep. what suitable advice may be in these scenarios, as well as possible alternatives. But before we do that, what do you think are the key principles and issues underpinning the development of a suitable advice solution?
Yeah, well, obviously it builds on what we've just been talking about. And also let's start, I know everyone's familiar with this, but it is very important. Let's start with the critical regulatory expectation. That advisors must start with an assumption that transferring DB assets away from the scheme is unsuitable. Or perhaps put another way, as we were just saying, you should start as an advisor by trying to meet the customer's income and capital needs by keeping the DB assets where they are, and only considering a transfer if you think their needs can't be met by keeping them where they are. Also, interestingly, and we've seen this plenty of times, haven't we? A borderline isn't really good enough. If you find yourself as an advisor sort of on the fence, is a transfer a good idea, is it not a good idea, the regulator would probably expect you to conclude that it isn't a good idea. A transfer must be clearly and demonstrably in the customer's best interest. So those are important foundation sort of ideas and principles. And as we've been saying, you need to consider the customer's personal circumstances, the hard and soft facts that you've gathered and how they impact any recommendation, the needs of their dependents, spouse or partner, how important that is. As I think you'll come to describe later, Rebecca, health can be a very, very important feature in this advice. And we talked last week about the importance of distinguishing between a customer's perception of their needs and your objective identification as an advisor of what their needs truly are. And indeed, customers with preconceived ideas about what their solution should be. Your job is to identify what they need in retirement and find the most efficient means of achieving it. Obviously, risk appetite we've talked about already. I think another important concept as you start to build a solution is identifying and understanding the importance of core secure income, by which I mean, sort of differentiating between essential income and things which may be more discretionary. So essential income would be making sure they have a roof over their head, making sure that food is on the table, all those sorts of things. So will your advised solution make sure that in any event, their core secure income that maintains their basic standard of living can be maintained? And then of course you can consider the role the DB scheme can play in that alongside their other assets. Legacy and estate planning, what actually do they need? How desirable is it really? Rebecca, you talked last week about legacy planning is great, but every penny that's kept aside to leave to those who are left behind after you is money that you can't spend yourself in your own retirement. And that leads us to talking about trade-offs. So your conversation and indeed your recommendation to the customer needs to present the various trade-offs that they may be asking to consider. It's very likely in the real world that not all of a customer's needs can be fully met. And that means that, whatever you advise may be to an extent in the customer's eyes, suboptimal. But that can be okay if the customer clearly understands the trade-offs that they're making and the disadvantages of those have been clearly spelled out to them.
Yeah, fine, good. I mean, we did talk as well, we touched on it last week and we mentioned it earlier, about cash flow modelling and capacity for loss, which sit well together. It might be worth exploring that now in a little bit more detail. You know, what do you think are the real benefits of cash flow modelling?
Yeah, okay. Well, I mean, firstly, consistent with this idea, I think that the APTA is at least as much conceptual as it is prescriptive. There isn't actually a formal requirement to do cash flow modelling. However, certainly in our work, we see an ever increasing expectation that some form of cash flow modelling will be done as part of the advice process, perhaps to the point where the FCA may well question why if you're not doing it, you know, why you're not doing it. So I'm sure everybody will know cash flow modelling is the projection using a range of assumptions of the income that can be generated from a customer's assets over the course of their retirement, their remaining lifespans. So in terms of advantages, well, for the customer, it sort of draws a really personal picture of their household's respective positions in requirement, whether remaining in or transferring out of the scheme, or perhaps in a range of different scenarios using their assets in different ways. And it helps to show the customer whether and how needs and goals can or cannot be met in those different situations. So it's a good way of bringing the advice to life for people. And of course, for the advisor, it brings all the facts and figures into one picture and attempts to show how that can develop during the course of somebody's retirement. And that in turn helps you to identify potential shortfalls in meeting the customer's needs or aspirations. And it helps you inform those trade-off discussions that we were just talking about that you can have with the customer. There are, of course, many different ways of working the cash flow modelling. We don't really have loads of time today to go into loads of detail. One approach that we have seen that we think works well, though, is for the model that's used to assume that savings and other investments are sort of eaten up, if that's the right term, first, which actually customers may not be all that comfortable with. But I think that demonstrates a sort of a purist view, if you like, on whether the customer's income needs can be met best by either remaining in or transferring out of the scheme. And the other big benefit we see with cash flow modelling is it's linked to capacity for loss. Again, it's a way of quantifying and almost stress testing the idea of capacity for loss. You can build into your cash flow modelling assumptions, which are commensurate with the customer's risk appetite, regarding various reductions in value or assets or income that may occur in certain situations, like, for example, you know, a global pandemic that wreaks havoc on the stock market. So it should, you know, it's a way of, again, quantifying and bringing to life for the customer. Should a serious event happen with your money that's invested, you know, will you still be able to meet your core income needs throughout your retirement? Hopefully that's helpful. Okay, Rebecca. So now we've discussed, albeit briefly, APTA, TBC and some of the principal drivers of advice. I'm going to ask you to bring this all to life. So I think you're going to talk us through a series of scenarios, which of course can be combined.
Sure. Yeah.
An advisor might face, and in each case, setting out the issues and when a transfer is more or less likely. So over to you.
Thank you, Peter. So we thought it would be a good idea, like you say, to bring this to life. And to look at some specific scenarios or driver's advice in more detail. We often see some common or recurring themes that have prompted a customer to seek advice in the first place. And we'll go through some of those common scenarios and we'll look to outline the main features, what the likely trade-offs are to consider, what good looks like, and perhaps some examples of when a transfer is more or less likely. And then maybe some ideas around sort of possible exceptions or alternatives. So first up, we thought we'd look at customers with serious ill health. So this is where a customer has reduced life expectancy. And we consider this is probably one of the most likely good reasons to override other factors that indicate a transfer is unsuitable. Obviously, staying in a DB scheme may not be in your best interest if you're not going to live very long. The fact finding that we discussed last week is key here, and advisors should be really exploring and establishing full details around illness and the sort of impact on longevity. In relation to trade-offs, I think as an advisor, you'll need to consider that a customer may get fuller value from the scheme if they stay in it and live longer than expected. So again, this is, you know, crucial that we understand sort of what the impact potentially might be on longevity. But then conversely, there are also some possible IHT implications on transfer if the customer dies within 2 years. So that's where, as an advisor, you'll need to sort of really be sort of weighing up, you know, what the impact of either of those scenarios might be. We consider that in the cases of serious ill health, a transfer is perhaps more likely to be suitable, particularly if life expectancy is significantly reduced, and or there's a partner that doesn't qualify for a spouse pension. Some possible exceptions or alternatives to this would be to explore PIE, so pension increase exchange, where perhaps customer could get a higher initial pension. There might maybe scenarios where a customer has significant other assets and has no need or wish to access or pass on DB assets, or we think, you know, that might be quite unlikely. And I think in any event, it's always a good idea to explore what serious ill health benefits might be available from the scheme, just to make sure that you're conducting sort of a full and fair comparison. So that's serious ill health. High CETV. We often see individuals seeking advice to transfer because they've received what they perceive is a high transfer value. So this is where the CETV appears high or attractive due to market conditions. And the issue, the main issue here, we think, is that customers may be distracted or incentivized by that CETV. Advisors will you know, have a hard job on their hands to try and overcome the now bias, which we've discussed previously. You know, we find some individuals may not even have ever considered seeking advice on their pension before they've seen a CETV amount, or, you know, pals of theirs having sort of transferred out relatively high CETVs. And I think in these situations, how best to meet identified retirement needs should drive the advice, with the CETV value itself becoming secondary. So that should be just sort of parked to one side, and all the normal sort of advice processes should continue as normal. Advisors should continue, should consider all sources of secure and other income available to meet their needs. And I think a lot can be gained here from having those transfer risk conversations that we talked about. We would consider that a transfer is less likely to be suitable on the grounds purely of a high CETV. Whilst the CETV may seem high, the transferred fund is then subject to the same market conditions that created it. And DC investment returns will be comparatively low, and the protections from the investment risk offered by the scheme will fall away. So I think they're the key things to sort of consider and debate there. Possible sort of exceptions or alternatives to that might be, you know, perhaps the customer is not reliant on their DB scheme at all to provide secure income, in which case that's a sort of a different conversation. Or perhaps a high CETV could potentially purchase a higher secure income than the scheme via other secured means, so an annuity, especially if we're sort of looking at single life or impaired enhanced annuities. Or in some situations, maybe the customer has a high attitude to risk and is an experienced investor and effectively wants to invest in a different market environment to the one that determines the transfer value. So there's sort of perhaps exceptions to that. We got examples of customers wanting or needing higher income. So this is where a customer is focused on securing as much income as possible. And I think here, cash flow modelling outputs that you talked about will be important. Is the scheme or a potential alternative the best way of meeting the customer's true retirement income needs? So this is really about establishing what those income needs are. And the trade-offs that you'll need to consider and talk through with your customer, you know, maximising income means less for other priorities, so perhaps spouse or partner income. And I think as an advisor, you'll need to use your discussions with the customer to work out and really facilitate what their red lines are. Is there scope to compromise or amend retirement spending? Are their goals realistic? And this is really where challenging and probing fact-finding comes into its own. do we think a transfer is more or less likely in these situations? So this driver alone wouldn't suggest a transfer is more likely to be suitable. And I think in practice, a cautious approach to withdrawal levels from a drawdown arrangement will be necessary to ensure sustainable income throughout retirement. So that's sort of the trade-offs with the transfer risk questions. Possible exceptions or alternatives to this would be the customer has a really high attitude to risk and perhaps wants to try and outperform scheme benefits, but there you'll be really looking at the experience that that customer has got and how they've demonstrated that in the past. I think your fact-finding questions, you'll also need to be comfortable that the customer's got the right attitude to transfer risk and that cash flow modelling stress testing should show sufficient capacity for loss. So that'll be key there. And I think as with the high CETV scenario, there may well be circumstances where transferring and buying an annuity could generate a higher income, again, for somebody with, you know, perhaps no need for sort of spouse or dependents benefits. The next topic we've got is flexibility. So this is where a customer wants or needs more flexible income. We see this driver of advice a lot. And some firms, you know, can justify and explain this very well, others perhaps less so. This is likely to be in a decumulation situation. And I think here the need for flexible income and sort of any ad hoc lump sums really need to be explored, challenged, detailed, and quantified. Again, fact finding is crucial here to understand what a customer needs, when, why, how. We know that there are limits and restrictions to the way benefits can be taken from a DB scheme compared to drawdown, and these need to be considered carefully. And obviously the likely trade-offs to consider will be things like, you know, maximising income means less money for other priorities. And ultimately, is the customer willing and able to take on board the associated transfer risk? And do they have the appropriate attitude to risk? We think in these situations, a transfer can be suitable. This area, along with sort of serious ill health and death benefit drivers on some occasions, is one where a transfer can add real clear value to a customer and could be suitable. But then you need to sort of consider if the DB scheme benefits are taken and can cover outgoings, then the customer already has flexibility in some respects. And it's also worth considering that the customer may not have as much flexibility as they think they'll have if they need to be cautious with their withdrawals. We see some people transferring out, you know, for these reasons, but then they're too afraid to touch the money in case it runs out. Possible sort of exceptions or alternatives, taking DB scheme benefits early and using PCLS to provide flexibility can be an option. Or the most obvious one, I guess, is to create the required flexibility using other assets. DC pots, often clients are in a current DC arrangement that tends to be sort of disregarded or forgotten when considering options with flexibility. Are there other, you know, investments, ISAs, savings? It's more preferable to use those, as obviously that's a less sort of risky situation. Can they defer retirement? You know, some people want flexibility, but sometimes deferring it by a couple of years, you know, can make things more affordable. And depending what they need flexibility for, can they look at borrowing? You know, can they look at sort of changing their job situation and having sort of flexible hours in that respect? Lots of things to consider with flexibility. other areas that we have, the age-old classic of customers wanting to retire earlier than the DB scheme, or we sort of tie this up with clients who are younger, you know, perhaps not quite at retirement age, wanting to consider transfer. So here, you know, we've got customers that are focused on retiring as soon as possible. You know, why wouldn't anyone want to retire as soon as possible? And I think even though early retirement factors from the scheme can be prohibitive, they should actually sort of be actuarial neutral and based on average life expectancy of the scheme. So it's always worth considering what can be obtained from the scheme. And then the sort of trade-offs to consider, a bit like we talked about earlier with fact-finding questions, having assessed income needs, is the customer being realistic? You know, is it really realistic to retire right now or retire early? Can other assets or holdings bridge any shortfalls or timeframe gaps? It might be a case of just sort of bridging income and, until state pension kicks in. and it's also worth considering, you know, early retirement can result in potentially lower transfer values than if the customer waits until nearer the scheme retirement age. Although obviously there's no guarantees about what the CETV will be in the future. And it's also very important to consider in these scenarios what death benefits will be lost on transfer, especially if you're transferring out before you can even take benefits. We think in these scenarios, especially where a customer is not yet in a position to take benefits, we'd question why advice isn't being deferred until retirement is actually possible. And where somebody is young, we think, you know, a transfer is less likely to be suitable and raises the why now question, why are we giving advice now? And probably the most obvious, and perhaps, you know, not so much considered, is the younger a client is, or the further away from retirement they are, the more difficult it is for them and you as an advisor to get a clear understanding of what their retirement income and capital needs might be. So sort of some alternatives here, you know, as the same sort of with wanting a higher income, you know, or having high CETV scenarios, there may be some circumstances when transferring or buying annuity can generate a higher income. But again, we'd consider why you're not doing that at the time that benefits can be taken. And I think, again, you know, having the conversations about what is realistic and achievable. And it might be perhaps your job as an advisor to explain to a customer that they actually can't retire as early as they want to. So it's about having those hard conversations. Maximising PCLS. So we do get some scenarios where customers want to maximise their PCLS. And this is where they're focused on obtaining as much sort of tax-free cash as possible. We know that DB scheme commutation factors tend to be less generous, and it's likely that a PCLS can be higher from a DC scheme. But it's again considering what the trade-offs are, you know, in order to obtain that. Can other assets or holdings bridge any capital shortfalls? You know, deferring taking benefits from the scheme can lead to the PCLS being higher. And it's also worth considering cash flow modelling outputs. You know, PCLS notwithstanding, is the scheme or an alternative the best means of meeting a customer's sort of true income needs? Whilst PCLS might be the driver, or tax-free cash might be the driver, we can't lose sight of the income needs that that scheme will provide. We think transfer is less likely to be suitable if maximising PCLS is the sole reason for transfer. And you need to establish, you know, in detail the key reasons for that high PCLS requirement and to see what can be done about that. Possible sort of exceptions, you know, customers might need a high PCLS for an important reason, for example, debt repayment, and therefore debt management will feature in your advice quite heavily here. A transfer could potentially be suitable if a customer is having sort of experienced severe financial hardship that they can be saved from. But again, that's sort of extenuating circumstances. And I think, as with other scenarios, circumstances where perhaps transferring to buy an annuity or another secure income that can be higher, it can be worth considering there. Death benefits. This is another key driver. It's very common. We see individuals seeking transfer advice to leave assets to somebody. You know, as we talked about earlier, it's a nice thing to do, but there are trade-offs to consider. And I think firstly, the key thing to establish here is how much the customer wants to leave, to whom, you know, and when. And it's worth remembering, you know, a pension's main purpose is to provide an income for you as the saver in retirement. And it's also worth bearing in mind that death benefits might look good immediately upon transfer, but in later years, you know, when death is more likely, that fund's going to be a lot smaller. So it's really sort of positioning all of that with the client and making sure they understand what might be left and when. The trade-offs, like we said, you know, if you want to leave money for people when you die, then that means there's less for you, you know, while you're living. And can the customer sort of compromise on whether other needs are more important, particularly when sort of other assets can be passed on, like house, you know, or other savings? Is a transfer more or less likely in these situations? Well, it all depends, really. It might be more suitable if a customer has got reduced life expectancy. But for a customer with normal life expectancy, transferring mainly to create a legacy is unlikely to be suitable, unless, of course, the DB scheme in question is sort of surplus to requirements. You know, in which case you could still sort of consider other ways of exploring all of the options there. Possible sort of exceptions or alternatives. So the most obvious is looking at sort of whole of life plans, life cover, depending on the age of the dependents that you're looking to provide for. And for some older customers, annuitizing, you know, maybe more suitable. Just a couple more. So debt management. We see instances where a customer has a significant debt to repay and is considering using the DB asset to pay off that debt. So here again, fact finding is key to understand, you know, what those debts are, what other means there are available to the customer to repay them. The trade-offs are similar to the ones that we've discussed. Using a DB asset to repay debt reduces the amount available to the customer and or their spouse during their lifetimes. And again, are there compromises available to the customer? You know, can they use other assets to repay debt? Or can they sort of park the sort of debt issue and make sure they're still funding for their retirement? A transfer is unlikely to be suitable unless there's absolutely no alternative. You know, is there a potential for real financial hardship? You know, and if there is, then perhaps, you know, a transfer can be justified. But it's worth considering that significant debt problems could sort of indicate other things, you know, so perhaps low capacity for loss, vulnerability, an inability to manage money, suggesting that perhaps transfer isn't the right thing to do. And, you know, most obviously, if the customer is still accumulating and still sort of saving for retirement, then plans to repay debt should be put in place first and foremost. You know, are there other borrowing options that are available or other assets to repay debt? And then I think sort of lastly, a driver for advice is scheme underfunding. So we see clients coming into us worried, you know, that their schemes are underfunded. Sponsoring employer may well have a funding plan in place, you know, but customers have their concerns nonetheless, which is understandable. And I think this is where it's worth really sort of putting the customer in an informed position. You know, if an employer fails and the scheme goes into PPF, deferred benefits up to a cap are largely secured at 90%. And whilst we know taking a definitive view can be difficult, it's having those conversations, you know, with the customer. If a customer is concerned about going into PPF and losing 10%, why transfer to a DC arrangement and risk losing more? How would losing 10% of a scheme income affect meeting retirement income needs compared to perhaps in a DC environment where, you know, a big sort of stock market crash could lead to an even more a bigger drop in income? With regards to suitability, even if a scheme is underfunded, this is unlikely on its own to be a good reason to transfer. Although some exceptions to that will be, you know, where a DB scheme pension is in excess of the PPF cap. So if there's really sort of big chunks of money that we're looking at, then, you know, you might want to consider alternatives, or perhaps where there's a high proportion of pre-97 benefits, or there is some time to go before retirement. I think in all of the scenarios that I've just sort of outlined quite quickly, or any combination of them, it's crucial as an advisor to consider the possibility of a partial transfer, or where relevant, you know, if there's multiple DB schemes, how they could interact with each other. So with regard to partial transfers, retaining sufficient assets in the DB scheme to provide core secure income that meets the customer's retirement needs is always going to be a good thing. So if there's a possibility of a partial transfer of transferring out a potential excess, then that could work, although it's worth bearing in mind that partial transfer amounts are usually sort of fixed and determined by the scheme. If somebody's in ill health and perhaps need to retire early, you know, retirement income can be boosted by a partial transfer with the purchase of an enhanced annuity. So it's worth considering what a partial transfer can do for the client. With regard to multiple schemes, multiple DB schemes and possibly, you know, a collection of DC schemes, ensuring sufficient income or sort of fixed discretionary spending is key. But it's worth considering what part each of those schemes plays independently. So do some or all of the schemes provide sufficient income to meet the customer's retirement income needs? What are the life cover options available? particularly if leaving a legacy is an objective, and consider what other assets the client has got to use, you know, especially if income flexibility is required. And I think the main thing here is that it's imperative that advisors consider whether or not a transfer is suitable for each DB scheme individually by considering them alongside each other. If the customer has got income security from, you know, some schemes, then the downside of transferring perhaps an excess or a surplus scheme is reduced, and then a transfer for that particular scheme might be more suitable. If the customer needs flexibility or wants to leave additional funds to a family, then transferring an excess scheme again is more likely to be suitable. But if the customer needs all DB schemes to meet income needs, then a transfer of any of them we think is unlikely to be suitable. So I think that's a sort of a quick whistle-stop tour through some of the scenarios, you know, and how to start thinking about formulating your recommendations. But I think the next most important thing is, once you've thought about that, is how you relay that in a suitability report. So, Peter, perhaps you could sort of talk us through some good practice with regard to suitability reports, what we've seen, what tips we can offer.
Yes. So, well, suitability reports perhaps are the ultimate in beauty being in the eye of the beholder. There are various schools of thought on the most effective approach to suitability reports, whether it's for this type of advice or anything else. And of course, the FCA has been accused, perhaps not always unreasonably, of wanting it both ways. You know, that they'll tell advisors you must provide all the detail that could possibly be relevant, so customers are in an informed position, whilst at the same time saying you must not drown customers in all sorts of information with unnecessary detail that obscures all the key points. So it can be tricky for advisors. We have seen some good things though, and the things that FCA seems to prefer. Perhaps the first thing to say, and I know this might sound very, very strange, but we see it all too often. If you're an advisor, give some clear advice. Too often we see suitability reports that don't actually give a clear, definitive recommendation about the course of action to take, whether or not that involves remaining or transferring out of the scheme. So make sure that whatever your recommendation is, it's very clear to the reader. And linked to that, I think, a bit of a bugbear of ours, and certainly the FCA's as well, is the equivocal or the conditional recommendation. You know, something that effectively reads along the lines of, if you feel this, then you should consider this action. If, on the other hand, you think that, then maybe this is better for you. I think we feel, and certainly the FCA feels, that that's almost an abdication of your responsibilities as an advisor. You know, the customer's perhaps paying you quite a lot of money and has a right to look for a clear recommendation. And, of course, the reasons for your recommendation must be very, very clear and directly related to the personalised hard and soft facts that you've gained and considered for that individual customer. There's nothing wrong at all in principle with using templates for suitability reports. The key objective, of course, is to present clearly and accurately suitable advice for the customer. So how you do that is up to you. And we've seen templates working very well, but there are dangers therein around the recommendation not being sufficiently personalised, or including things that don't apply to individual customers. The suitability report also needs to explain the alternatives that you've considered and explain why they were less appropriate than what you have actually ended up recommending. And we're sometimes asked, you know, there's a huge number of potential possibilities. Do I really need to identify and discount every single one of them? We think the answer to that is no. You can narrow the alternatives that you consider in depth and which you explain to a customer to only those with perhaps a potential or a realistic chance of being genuine alternatives that could meet that customer's individual needs. We should probably note some of the proposals in CP 1925 in this area. So the FCA is proposing a mandatory one-page summary to go on the front of the report, you know, highlighting the recommendation and all the key information that it would expect to be detailed in the report itself. And they go so far as to present some sort of example templates. So that's sort of the latest iteration of their thinking on, you know, striking this balance between pith, but also detail. And actually, you know, we've seen examples of advisors doing that kind of thing already, actually. And that strikes us as being good practice. Now, of course, one crucial aspect of the recommendation and the suitability report from your point of view as an advisor is whether and how it's peer reviewed. it's so important in this complex and high risk area of advice that as much as you possibly can, you have second opinions and second pairs of eyes. And that's something we're going to explore in a lot more detail next week as part of our discussion on controls and governance around DB pensions and advice. There we go, Rebecca.
Indeed. Thank you, Peter. Lots of good tips there. I think we are running out of time, but I wonder if we might have time to just take one or two questions. Yep. And then perhaps we can answer any that we don't get round to after this session. I've just seen one question come in. I know you talked quite a lot about cash flow modelling and whether and how to use that. We've had a question in about whether this should or shouldn't be used, and is this effectively mandatory now? Is the FCA sort of making this something that advisors need to do, do you think?
Yeah, so I mean, we sort of touched on that, didn't we? So officially, cash flow modelling is not compulsory. It's not listed or described in terms of things that form part of the APTA. But yes, you're right. I think as the question perhaps implies, whilst it's not mandatory, I think certainly the FCA will increasingly question why advisors aren't using it in this area of advice. I think they feel it's a very effective means of quantifying and bringing to life how all the assets that customer has, DB and other things together, may support their retirement and may be able to meet the needs and aspirations that they have. So it's not mandatory, but I think they say we'll ask questions if you're not using it.
Sure.
Let me ask you one in turn. When we talk about a client's needs, how should an advisor approach it when the customer really won't be all that specific around what income they feel that they need and they want? Can cash flow modelling drive out the specifics?
Yeah, so good question actually, and we see this quite a bit really. I think the main answer is that it's absolutely key to get specific details and information from the customer about what they need and what they want. Depending on how you position that conversation with the client, by setting out, the advice process, which obviously we'll talk about next week, but setting out the advice process and what is required from the customer in order for you as an advisor to give suitable advice. If using cash flow modelling is a way of, obtaining all of that information, then fine. But I think your job as an advisor is to make sure you have all of the information that you need in order to be able to give a suitable recommendation. And if you don't think you have that amount of information, then I think it needs to be made clear to the client that, without this information, I'm not in a position to provide you with a suitable recommendation. So it's key to have that information, and it's not okay to proceed without it. So obtaining that is key.
Yeah, no, I'd agree.
We've got one other question here. Oh, this is a good one. I would welcome your comments on solutions involving a transfer to cash. I think we talked about this last week, where we've seen instances of advisors transferring to cash and will decide on the makeup of the investments later. It seems to be quite prevalent before sort of various FCA reminders of what's required. It's still happening today as far as we can see. What are your thoughts on that?
Okay. Oh, yeah, interesting. I mean, I think hopefully we've been conveying our views over these sessions that the transfer advice does not exist in isolation, and it certainly doesn't exist in isolation from a recommendation that you have about what to do with the transfer monies. So I think in principle, I'm uncomfortable with an idea of, let's just proceed with the transfer. Let's get that bit done. Put it somewhere for a while and then we'll decide what to do with it. I think the FCA would be uncomfortable with that also, because your job as an advisor is to, as we've been saying, work out what a customer's retirement needs are and then cater for those. So catering for those involves working out how that income is going to be generated, and that involves where you're going to put the money. Perhaps one exception to that could be if there's some very, very pressing and specific emergency or unforeseen situation the customer finds themselves in, whereby as an advisor, you can be pretty confident that perhaps one of the scenarios you were describing earlier, Rebecca, might apply. You know, is the customer very, very poorly? And we really need to do something very, very quickly. Maybe the CETV is expiring or something like that. But that really, I think, is the only exception I can think of off the top of my head.
Yeah.
Actually, there's another question. There's a question here actually about expired CETVs. What are the risks posed by advising when the CETV was about to expire?
Interesting question. So I think that there are risks posed to the customer if advisors are giving advice on expired CETVs. I mean, we talked quite a lot about cash flow modelling and knowing what income a customer needs throughout retirement. As we all know, CETV value can change if it expires. So if you're basing your advice on a value that can change, then that can sort of potentially bring, the whole advice process into question, really. I think firstly, advisors should consider whether or not they can give advice in the required timeframe. You know, if a CETV looks like it's about to expire, can the advice process be completed in that time? And I think the first thing an advisor will need to do is maybe sort of contact the scheme and find out whether they're planning to sort of honour that CETV, how much it will cost to get a new CETV, what the situation would be. And I think if the CETV is already expired, I'd guard against providing advice in those situations, A, from a sort of a regulatory point of view, but also, for the risks posed to the client in those situations.
Yeah, okay. There's a couple of questions in the live chat as well, Rebecca. Let me ask you this one. Can we see a justification for transferring a DB scheme when a client is a significant time away from retirement, say 5+ years, if they're in good health? Maybe they have a high attitude to risk and capacity for loss and expect to draw benefits flexibly throughout their retirement. What do you think?
So I think generally where somebody is quite away from retirement, it's very hard to justify the reasons for transferring now. If you can really justify and explain the customer's ATR and experience is sufficient enough for them to want to take on board the risks associated with trying to sort of outperform the scheme, then you can do that. But I think you'd need to be looking at a customer with a lot of experience, evidential experience, so, lots of assets elsewhere. And I think in those sort of situations, you would expect to see that the client themselves are not that reliant on that DB scheme, because by virtue of the fact that they've got lots of experience, you'd expect them to have lots of other investments, and perhaps their reliance, on the scheme is perhaps reduced. So it is possible, but for most, sort of retail investors, we think it's less likely to be suitable if they're a long way from retirement.
Okay. Yep, interesting. A couple of questions here. Let me try and answer this one. How important is stress testing now, given the current crisis? Good question. It occurs to me there are two possible answers to that. The obvious one is, of course, yes, it's very important. Markets are very volatile at the moment. It's a very interesting time to be giving this type of advice, although, as I say, there may well be a need for it. So, yes, it's very important. But I suppose an alternative answer is, well, yes, it's important, but it's no more or less important than it's always been. If you are planning to sustain somebody's retirement and looking for ways to help them do that, then, as we were saying earlier today, then building in some extreme stresses, perhaps, depending on a customer's risk appetite, building in some extreme stresses into your cash flow modelling design is no bad thing whenever you happen to be giving the advice.
Sure.
And finally, let me ask you this one, Rebecca, finally. Would we always expect core needs to be secured, for example, an annuity or state pension where possible, rather than relying on a drawdown pension?
So I think in an ideal world, yes, having a secured income will always be preferable over having an unsecured income. But again, the factors around what the trade-offs are, would somebody rather have an income that's not secure and get other benefits like flexibility or whatever it might be. So it's sort of overlaying the concept of secure where possible. But again, it's discussing what the needs are of the customer. You know, on that basis, keeping a DB scheme at all costs is the way forward. It's just overlaying that with what a customer's true needs are.
Yeah, okay, agreed. Okay, I think I'm conscious of the time. We've run over, so thanks for everyone for staying with us. We should probably wrap it up there. If there are any more questions we've not addressed, forgive us, and we'll do our best to do that separately afterwards, a bit like we did after last week's session. You can see, hopefully, that our contact details are on the screen, and we'll send, as I say, a follow-up email after this session. Thank you again for joining us. We hope you found it interesting and useful. As we mentioned earlier, this is being recorded, and we'll disseminate it as quickly as we can afterwards. And if you're willing and able, we look forward to seeing you again next week for our final session in this series, when we're going to talk about the advice process. What does a good process look like, and its controls, and how it's governed? As we've been saying, outcomes for customers can be undermined if an advice process is not well controlled. So we're talking about that next week. So yes, thank you finally for joining us once again. We look forward to seeing you again next week. And in the meantime, please do stay safe and well.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
Cheers. Bye-bye.